Hello, I'm Randy Fertel. I'm here to interview Claudio Saunt, author of Unworthy Republic, The Dispossession of Native Americans and the Road to Indian Territory. First, a little business. New Orleanians in the audience may remember the name Ron Reinauer. He was an investigative reporter here who died suddenly 20 years ago. Ron was a George Polk Award-winning investigative reporter, but few knew that he was also the My Lai whistleblower. He wrote a letter to Congress and the Pentagon that uncovered the ugly truth that what the Army was declaring a great American victory against the Viet Cong was in fact the massacre of 504 unarmed elderly villagers, women, and children. I taught the literature of the war for a decade at Tulane, and Ron would come to my class and blow my students away with his story. When he died, I teamed up with some friends in New York and Washington, D.C., and we developed the Reinauer Prizes for Courageous Truth-Telling. We give four prizes a year, including a book prize. Claudio Saunt won the book prize last year. And so this is the second annual panel honoring the Reinauer Book Prize winner here at the Tennessee Williams Festival, something I'm very pleased to do since Ron was an adoptive New Orleanian and New Orleans is part of his story. So Claudio, welcome virtually to New Orleans. I'll give you a proper introduction in a moment, but first a little more business. I've been to conferences in California and in Canada where panels begin with an acknowledgement of the First Nation inhabitants of the land where the event is taking place. Given our subject matter today, it occurred to me that I should make such an effort. I'm a little uncomfortable in this. I'm unschooled, uninstructed, but I offer these words. Here in New Orleans, we stand on the land of the Chitimacha with the Atacalpa, Caddo, Choctaw, Homa, Natchez, and Tunica peoples, whose ancestors have resided here since time immemorial. Many First Nation peoples thrive in this place, alive and strong. And Claudio, who in Georgia stands on the lands of the Cherokee and Creek peoples, whose ancestors have resided there since time immemorial, many First Nation peoples thrive in that place, alive and strong. So, Claudio, again, welcome. You're the Russell Professor of History at the University of Georgia and hail from that other unique American city, San Francisco, that we like to think of as a sister city, sharing that uniqueness. It's a terrific book. And it's garnered glowing reviews from The Atlantic and The Times and The Post and a number of nominations and awards. Finalists for the National Book Award, the Robert Kennedy Book Award, it won that. The Bancroft Prize, it's just a really, really great book. I urge everyone to take a look at it. One thing about it is that right away you hit us, the readers, upside the head with a brick to try to dislodge what I'll call the classics illustrated version of American history out of our noggin. You challenge the words an Indian removal movement or removal act, as we call it, saying that it doesn't begin to capture the horrors of moving 80,000 Native Americans in the 1830s. Instead of the milquetoast removal, you prefer deportation, expulsion, and extermination as terms more accurate than removal. So can you tell us about that, how your book overturns that conventional history of America that Jackson promulgated with his Indian removal and this alternative narrative of U.S. history that you offer?
Yeah, so, you know, first off, thank you for that kind and generous introduction. And I wish we were speaking in person in New Orleans, but this online version will have to suffice.
Yep.
So you're right, I don't use the term Indian removal unless I'm quoting someone. And when I started this project, I was just dissatisfied with the literature about Indian removal. It never seemed to me to, it was high on melodrama, which is understandable. It's a terrible story. But it was kind of low on analysis and contextualizing this story when you think about the broader history of deportations and exterminations in the 19th and 20th centuries. So that's how I got interested in this project, just trying to rethink that story. But very early on, as I was doing my research, I discovered that Indian removal was really the term that was coined by the proponents of the policy in the 1820s and 1830s. And it's obvious why they chose that term. As the opponents observed at the time, it was a soft term. It didn't begin, and it doesn't begin to capture the violence that underlay the act. But despite that fact, we have been using that term ever since the law was passed in May of 1830, and it was passed down to us, and we've accepted it, and it appears in all of our historical accounts of the event. So I found that it was used by the proponents, and then the question was, well, what substitute terms can we use? And so, as you mentioned, I call it a deportation, and not without some hesitation, because a deportation refers to a country removing its own citizens. The United States, for example, cannot deport a Canadian citizen from Canada. It could extradite them, maybe, but it cannot deport them. Well, here the United States was deporting or extraditing or expelling people from their own nations, kicking Cherokees out of the Cherokee Nation. But I use the term because I think it captures the way that the United States was intruding on and dismantling Indigenous and not recognizing Indigenous sovereignty. And I also use it because it echoes throughout the 19th and 20th centuries. We are all familiar with the more infamous deportations of the mid-20th century in World War II. And I think there are actually some connections between these events. So I call it a deportation. I also call it an expulsion. That was a term that is historically accurate. It was used in the 1830s, and that is a term that some Indigenous peoples and other opponents of the policy used. And I also call it, at certain times and places, an extermination. And again, that's historically accurate. There were army officers and high-ranking army officers who recognized and said that the Secretary of War was going for extermination in the case of the Second Seminole War in Florida in the 1830s.
Well, you created an interactive graphic map that conveys some of this horror. And I think it would be a good thing to take a look at it because it's just stunning. You have to dig down into it to see the treaties that are being overturned in order to expulse these native peoples. But in 2 minutes, you'll see how they once inhabited all of America and then end up in tiny little bits out west. So if Tracy would please run Claudio's interactive map called The Invasion of America, it takes about 2 minutes. Invasion of America, that's an interesting label to put on it. How do you mean that, the invasion of America?
Well, it's intentionally provocative, but yeah. I want to challenge Americans to reimagine the early history of this continent. And I think it's we have a difficulty, professional historians know the story, although even then I'm not sure it's often fully taught in colleges. But I think it's a failure of imagination on the part of a lot of us to actually fully understand this early history, and that the entire continent, every square foot, was taken from someone, from some family or some larger community or nation. And so one of the things that I like about the visualization is exactly that you can see it unfolding before your eyes. And I think it captures us and has an impact in a way that written words often do not. So invasion is a prompt, a provocation, an encouragement for people to reorient their perspectives and to account for this long and really difficult history that unfolded and in some ways is still unfolding today.
To go back to Indian removal, that language in the Jacksonian world seemed to convey this quasi-humanitarian, we're going to save the Native Americans from, we're going to preserve their autonomy by moving them beyond the range of white harassment and abuse. But the removal was quite harassing and abusing. So your map gives us an image of that, and the detail that you go into in the book, the image after image of these horrors. For example, Alexis de Tocqueville stumbles on the removal of some, is it?
Choctaw families.
Choctaw in Memphis. And he describes it. Could you give us that image that he shares?
Yeah, he sees a party, and this is in the middle of the winter. And in fact, it was an extremely harsh, unusually cold winter. And this was the peak of it. This winter storm had descended on this body of people who had been uprooted from their homelands, and they were moving across the Mississippi River. They're actually boarding a steamboat on the Mississippi River. And he described that event and asked one of the Choctaws about this deportation, expulsion, and the man responded very somberly that he was moving in order to be free. Certainly an irony, yeah. A dark irony. And he also describes seeing a very, very elderly Choctaw woman in her 70s, 80s, or 90s on board on the top deck of the steamboat, just covered with a very small blanket, not even large enough to really cover her shoulders, and sitting there and shivering in this in these sub-zero temperatures. So that's just one snapshot of these stories of expulsion, and it unfolds over the space of almost a decade. And there are all kinds of ways in which people were uprooted from their homelands and transported. So some people had to walk on foot, as many Cherokees did in late 1838 and 1839. Some people went partially up by foot and then boarded steamboats. Some people went in chains. I mentioned the horrendous weather, which struck some of the parties. There was also a cholera epidemic that swept through the nation. Really, in fact, it's the first cholera epidemic ever to strike North America in 1832, 1833. And cholera tends to thrive in overcrowded, unsanitary conditions. So steamboats were the perfect vessels for outbreaks of this disease, which had extraordinarily high rates, mortality rates. So so as I say, that's just one brief snapshot, but there is a decade's worth of stories like that.
The steamboat in the dominant culture is a kind of a symbol of freedom, of exploration, of getting beyond the next horizon. But what did that image of the steamboat mean to Native Americans?
Right, it's this symbol of progress, often in the kind of U.S. imagination, technological advance. It opens up the heart of the continent. It's you can move more quickly and more efficiently and carry heavy things and get things to market. So it opens up the whole center of the continent all the way up the Missouri River in the 19th century. But for indigenous peoples, they were really floating prisons, and they were herded on board these vessels and stuck on them for weeks at a time. They were often not allowed to, the latrines were filthy, and not surprisingly, they were not allowed to disembark at any time. So they're not symbols of progress, but symbols of invasion and dislocation. And, you know, at the very same time, these steamboats are carrying enslaved peoples, because as indigenous peoples are removed from their homelands and uprooted from their homelands in the South, planters are shipping in enslaved people from the East Coast, largely from the Chesapeake region. Again, some go overland on foot, but other people are put on steamboats and shipped around the Gulf and up the Mississippi River. So the steamboat means entirely different things to indigenous people and enslaved people in the 19th century.
So your story overturns what I think of as the classics illustrated American history narrative of manifest destiny, that we were destined to bring civilization across the continent, getting rid of the savages and bringing light to the darkness. How does manifest destiny figure in this?
So that's a term that's coined a little later in 1845, mm-hmm. but the sentiment certainly existed in the 1820s and 1830s. So you mentioned earlier that in the Jacksonian era, there are individuals, including Jackson himself, who try to spin this as a humanitarian undertaking. Yeah. And, and some people do that very cynically. It's apparent that they don't believe it for even a second, but they need to sell it to Congress. It's fundamentally a law has to get through Congress to fund this whole enterprise. And they need to sell it to the American public. So very cynically, you can see, especially planters, these planter politicians in the South who have their eyes on what we call the Black Belt. It's this fertile land that arcs through Alabama, present-day Alabama and Mississippi, but back then it arced through the Creek Nation and the Choctaw and Chickasaw Nations. And so planters in Georgia were eyeing these lands. And of course, cotton was the most valuable export in the United States at the time. And so these were some of the most valuable lands in the entire world. And they thought that they were not being used effectively and efficiently. So they wanted to get rid of indigenous peoples. So the story they told, again, cynically, is that this was a philanthropic humanitarian enterprise, that they were moving Native peoples who simply couldn't keep up with the dynamism of the United States. They were moving them to lands west of the Mississippi where they would be able to thrive. And they spun all kinds of unbelievable stories that Native peoples would join together and form a state that would then be admitted into the Union, and they would be largely self-governing, but of course always with white people at the very top of this governing hierarchy. But then there are some other people who I think who sincerely believed that it was the best thing for Native peoples. There were some, I think, naive missionaries. Yeah, naive missionaries who felt that that if they weren't expelled from their lands, that they would ultimately go extinct or become, and so this was rhetoric that was circulated widely, and Jackson and Jackson's administration planted these stories in newspapers, and it was an effort and a struggle for Native peoples to combat it. They didn't have the same voice, obviously, mm-hmm. in the public forum, although they did everything they could to counter this rhetoric and to make it clear that this was not being done for their own benefit. This was being done because Americans were greedy and wanted their land.
Yeah, so let's talk about who benefited, the dollars and cents of this. How much was spent on the removal, and who benefited from that expenditure?
Yeah, it's, I call it at one point in the book, the war that the slaveholders won. Mm-hmm. And that's because it's largely driven by politicians and slave owners in the South. Of course, they find Northern support. But bankers, and I'll touch on that in a minute. But they do find Northern support, and there are individuals out in Ohio and Indiana who want to invest in canals. And on occasion, the canal, the best route for the canal was right through indigenous land. So there was a reason to move these peoples. But nonetheless, this is a hotly fought political battle in nationally and in Congress. And I think without the South pushing this at every turn, the law might not have been passed. So I think we can really put Southern politicians and slave owners right at the top when we think about responsibility. But you mentioned bankers as well. And one of the surprising things I found in researching this story is that Wall Street was heavily involved in this. And of course, Wall Street had been involved in financing the slave trade and cotton exports. So it was natural in some ways for them to see this opportunity in the South and to seize it. And they wrote back and forth to each other and said, this is a once in a lifetime, once in a millennium, sometimes they would say, opportunity to make just tremendous, tremendous profits. Because as Native peoples were expelled from their lands, Wall Street bankers could swoop in, speculate in the land, and then turn around and resell it to planters, sometimes at a profit that was, it could easily be 3,000% in some instances. So the speculation is rampant. Wall Street's leading financiers get involved. I follow the story of one man named J.D. Beers, who was right at the top of the financial hierarchy in the 1830s. And in fact, even European investors get involved in this by buying state bonds, which are used to finance this transformation of indigenous farms and homesteads into these sprawling slave plantations.
You mentioned the Black Belt, which describes that rich land that was once the edge of the Gulf, and so was fertile with all the things that was left behind when the land expanded, when the Ice Age. I don't know the geology, but it's ironically called the Black Belt in part because it's where all the blacks ended up, because that's where they needed the labor. And one of the ironies of history is that if you look at that belt that stretches from Atlanta across Birmingham, Montgomery, it's also where the civil rights movement got most of its energy. Mm. So it turned around. So I was thinking about the end of Huck Finn, when Huck says that he's tired of civilization, a word he can't even spell, and he's going to light out for the territory ahead of the others. And I wondered if you ever thought about, so we think that it is set in the 30s, maybe the early 40s. It's written in 83. When the called the Boomer movement in Oklahoma is pushing back against any more Indians being brought in. So I wonder if, you know, the thought experiment, have you ever wondered what Huck would have seen if he had lit out for the territory at the end of Huck Finn? Huck Finn is a novel about the a satire of the shore, the people on the shore who have normalized slavery. So it's a satire of the normalization of the abuse of people. And so I ever thought about
if there had been a continuation? So
what would Huck have seen?
Right. So part of this story, I don't get into this in the book. I'm really interested in this process of uprooting and expulsion in the book. But when they arrive in Indian territory, as it's officially designated, so it's largely present day Oklahoma and part of Kansas. They're dropped in what is, from their perspective, the middle of nowhere. And a lot of these folks had intermarried with white and African-American families in the East, and they had economic connections as well. And that was one of their objections. They didn't want to go out West. And in fact, they said they didn't want to be surrounded by salvage Indians. I mean, they used that term even. So they're dropped there. The federal government promises them 12 months of rations because it's the 1830s, so you can't go to the supermarket to buy your food. You need to clear land and you need to start planting and you need to have something to harvest the next year, or you're going to starve. But they're leaving behind hundreds, thousands of years of accumulated generational knowledge about how to survive in their homelands. They're leaving that behind and they're placed somewhere where they don't know where to plant, where the fertile soils are, when to plant, what medicinal plants exist. And so they have to start almost from zero. And so, it doesn't go well in the early years. In part, they sometimes arrive in the wrong season, so they can't get the fields cleared in time. They can't get the crops in. There's a devastating flood one year. The Arkansas River overflows. Well, this is something they would have understood and known about back in their homeland, but they weren't familiar with the waters of the Arkansas. So it washed out all of their crops. And so they ended up literally starving. And there were appeals sent to Washington, D.C., and the answer came back. We don't have funds for that. And besides, that's a form of welfare, and we need to teach people to be able to survive on their own.
The Republicans...
That ideology is deeply, deeply rooted in American history. So these difficulties are reflected in the population growth and the mortality and birth rates in the late 1830s and 1840s. But what's really astonishing is just the resilience and that they are able to reestablish their nations. And those nations still exist today, and they're much stronger now than they were 100 years ago. So that's a kind of success, despite all of the adversity that these people had to face. But you mentioned that Huck Finn is written in the 1880s. So indigenous peoples rebuild their nations, and then in the 1880s, Congress comes along. They had been promised these lands. As long as the waters run and the grass grows.
But oily.
That was the premise of this uprooting, that they could not expect to hold on to their lands in the East, but if they moved west of the Mississippi River, there white people would never bother them. They would have permanent title to the land. And of course, indigenous peoples were dubious about that from the beginning. There had already been a lot of promises that had been broken. So they were suspicious and rightly asked, why would this promise be any more reliable than any of the other promises that you've given to us? And of course, they were proven right, because as I said, in the 1880s, the United States turns around and says, we now think that the best thing for you is for us to divide up your land in severalty, as they said, basically to take all of this land that was held communally by each nation, to divide it into separate parcels, sometimes 160 acres, sometimes a little larger, sometimes a little smaller, to give that land out to individual families, and then to treat the landowners as kind of individual property owners. But what that meant is
divide and conquer.
Yeah, divide and conquer, and that there was a frenzy of speculation. People couldn't, people were tricked out of their land. Sometimes they were forced at gunpoint to sign deeds turning over their land. Sometimes they were promised X amount of dollars, but were paid only a fraction of that or paid nothing. Sometimes they couldn't meet their obligation, their tax obligations once they held the land privately. So an enormous fraction of that land then eventually passed into the hands of white Americans.
When is oil discovered there?
In that same era. So in the 1890s.
That's part of that story.
Yeah, and Angie DeBow wrote about this, a wonderful book about this in the 1940s. Most of Oklahoma's leading families got their start by stealing Indian land and making a fortune on the oil that was underneath the ground.
What's the old adage? There's always a murder at the bottom of every American fortune or something like that, a crime. So I imagine that there's some people who think your book is a bit of a crime, and I wonder if you have any hopes of it having some effect on the teaching of U.S. history. I wonder if you've had some pushback, some cancellation. I wonder if your book's been burned anywhere. It's not a story that a lot of people, not all people are going to like.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, my book is one brick in a much larger edifice that that people have been building for a couple generations. And so, you know, I'm happy to contribute to that construction. It does matter. It does make a difference. And I've seen it make a difference, but it's not one way. There's pushback, as you say. And so we really have a long way to go. I mean, we talked about the visualization, that map that I online map I made. Again, I don't think there's a failure of imagination, and then very concretely, there's just a failure in schools for us to teach Americans this history. So, you know, I've seen, I teach in Georgia, and I know in the high school level, people are introduced to the subject of the 1830s and the expulsion of indigenous Americans. And they're taught that it's a bad thing, a kind of tragedy, but there's always a sense of inevitability.
Mm-hmm. Manifest
destiny. Native peoples couldn't have survived anyhow. And moreover, I don't think, well, I know it's not taught as being central, absolutely central to the way that the United States developed in the antebellum era, because it transforms.
The central narrative is progress, industrialization.
Yeah, it transforms the South, because only 30 years before the outbreak of the Civil War, the very heart of the Deep South is indigenous country. Mm-hmm. So we're Birmingham, Montgomery, Jackson, Mississippi, that is all Indian land in 1830. So, you know, it's transformed in the matter of just a few decades. And that's one of the things I try to bring out at the end of my book. And in just a matter of a couple years, you have these forested areas or areas that are farmed by indigenous families, it's largely subsistence farming. They are clear cut. Planters move in and describe the orchards, they're peach trees with enormous trunks that Choctaws had been cultivating over the generations. They have to cut them down and uproot them and turn it over to cotton cultivation. And then these areas are flooded with enslaved people who then have to work on the land for the next couple decades until the outbreak of the Civil War. So it is central to how American history unfolds in the first half of the 19th century. It's not
without Indian removal, there's no Civil War because there's no cotton culture.
I think that's right. I mean,
that's a powerful statement.
Yeah, the Confederacy and the heart of the Confederacy is created really in the 1830s. So it's not a side story to American history. It's not simply a dramatic, sad and regretful story. It is fundamental to the way that this nation developed. In terms of pushback, a lot of the pushback is to score political points, and it's in the news, and there's very little substance to it. So I think, some things rise to the surface and Fox News might fixate on one particular thing, but totally overlook some other thing that's actually a much darker and more difficult story about American history. So, fortunately I haven't had to deal with that part of American politics.
I would have liked to have seen you on the Colbert Report. So one of the things you talk about is how the Indian removal, quote unquote, schooled international removals, that there are other nations that learn from us how to do this. So could you talk about that? It's not a pretty picture.
Yeah. So I mentioned at the outset, I when I got into the project, I was interested in situating this in this much larger story of deportations and exterminations in the 19th and 20th centuries. And I'm not out to make the case that those other stories, awful stories that unfold in later in the 19th and 20th centuries, were caused by what happened in the United States in the 1830s. That's certainly not the case, but I do think, in fact, it's clear that other state administrators in the 19th and 20th centuries looked to US policy uh-huh. as a guide and as an inspiration for how a state can modernize and how it could deal with people who, as they saw it, didn't belong to the body politic, people who were backwards. Mm-hmm. And they say this explicitly. So there are, in German Southwest Africa, state administrators at the end of the 19th century and early 20th century, I talk incessantly about the United States mm-hmm. And about what it did to Native Americans. And that's a model for what Germany did to the Herero people in southern Africa. And before that, we talked about Tocqueville. Well, he goes back to France and then eventually goes to mm-hmm. Algeria mm-hmm. and observes that, this is a model. We should do in Algeria what the United States did in North America. We need to.
And they did.
They tried to. The demographics were a little different, as it turned out. And that was one of their frustrations. They would say, the United States was able to do that. It's much more difficult for us, they would say, because the populations are not dwindling in the same way.
But they started calling the Algerians indigène.
Right. That's exactly right. This was a word that had been reserved for indigenous people in the Americas, indigène, but in the 1830s, they start to apply it to Algerians. So they're directly, obviously, making that connection. There are Russian imperial administrators in the Caucasus in the middle of the 19th century who say, these people are Indians, and we need to deal with them in the same way.
They are Indians.
Yeah. And most notoriously, Hitler says that the Volga River must be our Mississippi, that we need to treat Eastern Europeans just as the United States treated Indians. And he says, and who's going to remember you know, a generation later, what happened to Eastern Europeans when Germans are eating bread from wheat grown in Ukraine? Who's going to remember what we did to those Eastern Europeans? Because who remembers what the United States did to Indigenous Americans?
Now, of course, Germany learned about eugenics from America.
And that's right. There's a whole other connection in the 1930s when they looked at U.S. law. So lots of connections. And again, I don't mean it would be foolish to say that one caused the other, but I simply want to make the point here that the United States belongs to this long and really ugly history of states expelling people who they think don't belong to the body politic.
Yeah. So not only does your narrative spill over into an international narratives of displacement, but it's not ancient history. What I'm thinking about is the what's called ICWA, the Indian Child Welfare Act, which was promulgated in federal law seeking to keep Indian children with Indian families. That was the language they used. It was passed in 1978 in response to compelling evidence of the high number of Indian children that were being removed from their families by public and private agencies, put into orphanages, put up for adoption with non-native families. In other words, it meant to prevent a renewal of the Indian Removal Act. Is that fair to say? ICWA was a response to a renewal of?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's part of this much longer history of the United States, dealing with what administrators call the Indian problem. At the end of the day, wanting these people to go away. And sometimes that meant literally moving them, forcing them west. Sometimes it meant going to war against them and killing them. Sometimes it meant formulating policies that would turn them into, you know, good white Americans, as they saw it. And so adoption is part of that process of wanting to get these people out of their families and, in essence, kind of make them, force them into the melting pot, make them disappear and their native identity disappear.
So I've learned from Rebecca Nagel's very fine podcast called This Nation, I think. Is that the name of it?
Yes, This Land.
This Land. That there's a very well-funded conservative appeal to the Fifth Court Circuit of Appeals, that is the New Orleans Circuit of Appeals decision, which supported ICWA, who said, yes, this is the law of the land and it's a good law. But there now comes the conservatives who are trying to repeal ICWA as unconstitutional. And it's, I think, going to be reviewed by the Supreme Court. Apparently, the last time they reviewed Native American issue, it didn't go well. And now with the court so imbalanced, it doesn't sound like it will go well if they take it up. Are you following Rebecca's podcast?
I love that podcast. I recommend it to my students. I think there are two seasons to it. And the second season deals with ICWA. And the first season deals with McGirt v. Oklahoma, which was decided just last year, which also ties into this discussion we're having, because in that case, it was actually a victory for Indigenous nations. Mm. And the opening line of the decision written by Justice Gorsuch was it read, at the end of the Trail of Tears, was a promise, right? I mean, and that's that promise that this is your land as long as the waters run and the grass grows. But that promise had been broken. And so the case was about exactly that. Did and does the Creek Nation, and by extension, other Native nations in Oklahoma, do they still have sovereignty over these lands, even though that promise was broken at the end of the 19th century? So that decision was decided favorably for Indigenous nations. It's not fully clear what all the implications are, because that then will need to be litigated in the lower courts for the moment. You know, does that mean that they have the ability to, for example, regulate environmental matters on their land? So we'll have to see about that. And there's already pushback about that decision from the state of Oklahoma. So, so these things are kind of unpredictable, how they will play out. And I think as Rebecca's podcast makes clear, often Indian affairs get caught up in much larger political debates and fights between the right wing and the left wing. They're often collateral damage. And in fact, the people waging these legal battles could care nothing about Native peoples, but they are nonetheless casualties in some of the decisions.
So we're almost out of time. And so let me say how pleased I was to bring your book under the Ridenour Prize banner, because as we spoke about at the prizes last fall, there's a through line, that there's a connection between this pattern of extermination and the Vietnam War and My Lai in particular. One way to understand our determination to fight that war, it's very complicated, but part of our attitude was, these people are savages, these Vietnamese are savages because they believe in communism. It was a kind of ideological savagery that wasn't democracy. And so we have to exterminate it. So anyway, could you just talk about how you see the connection between My Lai and what you write about?
Yeah, and there are lots of ways to kind of get at this question. I mean, for one, we could talk about the Second Seminole War. So this is waged in the swamps of Florida against a few thousand Seminole refugee families who are hiding out from U.S. troops in between 1835 and 1842. And the United States spent 7 years chasing down these families and shooting them down in these swamps. And it's extraordinarily costly, both morally and financially. It's widely unpopular in the United States because these stories are getting back. And in fact, you can read some of the diaries left by soldiers who are entirely demoralized by what they're doing. And they recognize the injustice of it. They're chasing these people through their homelands and—
It sounds familiar.
And killing them. And the soldiers aren't sure why they're doing it. Or there's some pretense that, you know, a treaty was violated by the Seminoles, but the soldiers know it's not true, and they say that. So it's demoralizing. A lot of these soldiers turn to drink and other drugs to deal with the pain of this. A lot of them die of disease, or they come back with permanent injuries, psychological and physical. In fact, one of the diaries I read was from a soldier, West Point graduate, who waited around in the swamps in Florida and just, you know, was kind of blistering in his criticism and was disgusted by what he was doing. But he ended up back in Athens, Georgia, where I live today. And he died in his early 40s, basically became addicted to morphine and alcohol, and died in his early 40s. And he's buried not far from my house. You know, so there's that kind of connection. But there are more concrete connections too, because the United States' first kind of Asian imperial excursion is in the Philippines and in 1898. And there, and the United States and administrators explicitly say, these people are just like Indians. They're indigenous too. We need to borrow, you know, we need to do to them what we did to Indians. And that means putting them on reservations. That means creating a kind of educating them in a way that can turn these inferior peoples at least into useful, as they see it, subjects of the country. The Bureau of Insular Affairs is created to manage the Philippines. It's modeled on the Bureau of Indian Affairs. So
we take some of the slurs used in the Vietnam War from the Philippines War, slope, gook, some of those racial slurs actually were just holdovers from the Philippines War.
Right. And we still hear terms like off the reservation anytime the United States ends up at war. And of course there are Black Hawk helicopters, Apache helicopters, Tomahawk missiles. So, you know, all of this iconography is drawn from these wars that the United States waged in the West in the 19th century, and then by extension across the Pacific in Asia. So, there are lots of connections kind of culturally, but also really just explicitly when you look at who's involved in the Philippines in the late 19th century. There's the same officers who were fighting Indians in the West. So it's part of that much longer history of U.S. imperial expansion.
Yeah. Well, I guess we're out of time. This was delightful. Great to spend this time with you, Claudio. And it's a terrific book. I urge everyone to get a copy of Unworthy Republic, a perfect title, Unworthy Republic, The Dispossession of Native Americans and the Road to Indian Territory. I hope to see you again soon.